What's up, FHN?
I'm Max.
And I'm Sassy.
This week, we've got segments ranging from Animal Crossing-themed cupcakes to an album review.
The nightly show starts now. Are out today for the senior zoo trip.
It's that time of year where us seniors have a lot of events coming up.
Be sure to look out for information on things like graduation practice and prom on April 19th and the all-nighter on June 1st, the night of graduation.
Now, let's go down to downtown St. Charles and take a look at a soda museum with this video by Taylor Saale.
New businesses are appearing on Main Street with the brand new soda museum and arcade being one of them. The museum holds 7,000 to 8,000 items of memorabilia ranging from different brands such as Coke and Pepsi. The museum's owner, Tom Smith, has been collecting since 10 years old to today. But what brought about the idea to make his collection into a museum?
I told my dad when I was 15 years old that I really enjoyed my Coca-Cola stuff, and I really enjoyed when he had his friends coming over and I would tell him all about my items, and I had my own friends coming over and we would vend a soda bottle out of a Coke machine in the basement, and I just enjoyed sharing the history of the items with everybody. Because a lot of these items, whether it was how it was used in advertising or actually specifically where the item came from, I just always enjoyed the history of the items and enjoyed sharing it with others. I told my dad when I was 15 that someday I was going to open a museum.
And just like in his childhood, he also got the idea to add an arcade into the soda museum.
When I was 10, I had a Coke machine, and my friends would come over and for a quarter, they would vend out a soda, and we would hang out and play our video games and Atari and stuff together. And my dad said, "What do you think about me getting a pinball machine?" And I'd put a pinball machine next to your Coke machine. And I said, "That sounds like a great idea." And so a pinball machine arrived one day, and it was a lot of fun. It became that a lot of my friends didn't want to play against me anymore, because obviously when you have the pinball machine at your own house, you get pretty good at it. So I said to my dad, "Why don't we, get another pinball machine and then just keep kind of adding to it." His idea was, "Why don't we just get a different pinball machine? So we'll get a new one and sell that one." And so he did. He got a couple more, and he started kind of collecting pinball machines and arcade games. And then after I got married and had kids of my own, I bought some arcade machines for my own game room at my house. And what we have downstairs is kind of half stuff that my dad collected over the years and half stuff that I found.
But he didn't want to only show his collection. He also wanted to bring a sense of nostalgia to people who come in.
I want people to be able to step kind of down memory lane and remember things from their own youth that they see here. So, the museum in Atlanta has a beautiful leaded glass chandelier that you see when you walk in. It's from the 1890s, and it's wonderful. But there's no one that's going to walk into the museum in Atlanta that points up to that and says, "I remember that," because they're long gone. But here, you can come in here and you can see a Max Headroom skateboard from the 1980s. And people my age, at least, will point to that and say, "I remember it." And something like that's not on display at the World of Coca-Cola in Atlanta.
The Soda Museum is going to become somewhere that you can visit more than once, as items are going to be rotated throughout the museum, as the collection might be swapped in and out for different items. And write-ups are now being made to share more of the history for the items.
For soccer fans, the NWSL starts this weekend. The Kansas City Current have spent the last year constructing their home stadium, the CPKC Stadium, which is the first exclusively women's soccer stadium in the world. The Current race facing Louisville this Saturday, March 16th, for the first game in their new stadium. Now, we have a video by Jacob Bass on Please Don't Touch Anything 3D.
Warning: this video may contain spoilers for Please Don't Touch Anything 3D. Please Don't Touch Anything 3D by Forward XP and Bethesda Studios is a first-person 3D-based puzzle game. You're in a room with some cabinets, a screen with a city on it, and a panel with a singular button. A guy tells you to keep an eye on the room while he's gone and gives you one instruction: don't touch anything. In this video, I'll be telling you about my 5 favorite endings out of the 30 endings in the game. So first up is ending 8, the reverse ending. Press the button 8 times and grab the screwdriver to your right, then unscrew the panel here to get to these colored buttons. Put in the code green, red, yellow, blue, which can be found on the instructions poster to your right. Then watch the world flip. This is one of my favorite endings because it's short, but it has a really amusing ending to me. Next is ending 9, the black hole ending. Press the button twice and input the code 312213 into the 3 numbered buttons. This can also be found on the instructions poster to your right. Pull the lever that pops up to the left and input 8267 onto the keypad that appears. This code can be found in a folder on your left. Then, type 1244 into the 1 through 4 keys that appear afterwards. This code is also found on the instructions poster. Then, watch the world end. This is another one of my favorite endings because it's a really cool looking ending to me. Next is ending 15, the City Boom ending. To get this ending, press the button twice and input 312213 into the 3 buttons. Pull the lever to the left and input 8008 into the keypad. Then, press the button 14 more times to get this hammer and pry open the drawer down here. Take the cartridge and put it in this slot. Then, just tap the screen to drop bombs on the blocks and clear the screen. This one is one of my most favorite endings because it's just really fun to play a mini game. Next is ending 18, the Happy Demon ending. Press the button twice and input 312213. Then, input this into the 4-button panel in the upper left corner of the big panel. Upper right, bottom right, bottom right, upper right. On the new panel on your right, hold the gray button until all 3 dials say 6. Then, hit the red button above that gray button. Then, on the panel that lowers down from the ceiling, click every button except the eye, hourglass, upward-facing key, and double wave. Then watch the chaos. I really like this ending because, honestly, I think the blobs are pretty cute. Lastly is ending 20, the Stanley Parable ending. To get this ending, you need to do the second ending where you press the button 20 times in a row twice. Then, this will pop up, and you'll hit the button. Then hit the new buttons. And then the new buttons. And so on and so forth until you get the ending. I like this ending because it's a great reference to another game I like a lot, and I like pressing the buttons. And that's my 5 favorite endings from Please Don't Touch Anything 3D.
To any of you Olivia Rodrigo fans, she's here at St. Louis tonight at the Enterprise Center.
She'll be playing a mix of music from her Sour and Guts albums. I hope if you have tickets to go see her, you have a great time.
Looking at another artist, Riley Aldenderfer has a new album review looking at Good Kid, Maad City by Kendrick Lamar.
Welcome back to another album review. Today, we'll be talking about Kendrick Lamar's second studio album, Good Kid, Maad City. This album is based on Kendrick's experience in growing up on Compton. This album explores topics like mental health, finding oneself, and others. Today, we'll go over my personal favorite, my least favorite, and my overall rating of the album. First, let's talk about my favorite song on the album. This album has a lot of great hits, like the trap of Maad City and the deep personal rap of Sing About Me, I'm Dying of Thirst. But in my opinion, Sing About Me, I'm Dying of Thirst is my favorite song on the album. The storytelling is some of the best I've ever heard in the song. Mixed with the beat switch between Sing About Me and I'm Dying of Thirst, it really brings a theme together of a kid trying to get out of gang life. Now, let's talk about my least favorite song in this album. For me, this is between 2 songs, Real and Compton. But in my opinion, Compton is the worst song in this album. I get why it's necessary, with it showing Kendrick getting out of the streets of Compton, but the West Coast inspired instrumental just seemed out of place. Overall, this is one of the best storytelling albums I've ever heard. The endless re-listenability, mixed with the clear view of Kendrick's past, makes this an amazing album. Overall, I give this a 9.8 out of 10.
Last week, Eagles center Jason Kelce officially announced his retirement. After 13 seasons, Kelce has been one of the best in the game. He's been in 7 Pro Bowls, he's a 6-time first-team All-Pro, and was a 2018 Super Bowl champion. He will truly be missed. Turning to spring sports, we have a video by Max Fitzsimmons on the local tennis coach.
Well, my name is Daniel Gomez, and I'm a tennis professional at Veta West. In my recent years of experience, I've heard that some of the people that play tennis, they think tennis is an easy sport. That's why some of them choose it. They don't want to choose something like football, that it's like rough on the body and people have to tackle and like do all these crazy workouts. So they decide to play tennis because they think it's an easy sport. But what they don't understand is if they want to be good, they have to put a tremendous amount of work into it and a lot of hours on court. So people have this misconception of tennis. They think it's easy, but it's actually one of the hardest sports to learn, you know, and that's one of the things. It's physical until you get good. It is physical until you get really good. Once you get really good, it stops being physical and it becomes mental. So just don't choose tennis if you think it's an easy sport, because you're gonna get frustrated and you're gonna get burned out. My favorite part about coaching, it's definitely connecting with my players and just seeing how they trust me with time. At first, some people don't trust me because I look young or because I, you know, whatever. But once they know I know, and once they know I care about them, then they start to listen more and they start to, you know, build that trust player coach. And when that, you know, when that connection is established, people improve.
March Madness will be starting up this week. I hope you all have had your brackets filled out and ready to go.
I'm sure this will be another exciting tourney.
Since UConn won last year's tournament, let's see if they can win again, or we'll see if we have a new champion this year.
Next up, we've got some sweet treats ready for you with a DIY from Taylor Saale showing you how to make fruit cupcakes straight out of Animal Crossing New Horizons.
Hello FHN, today I'm going to show you how to make imitation fruit cupcakes from Animal Crossing. First, I like to take any white cake mix, as I like to keep my recipes budget friendly. You're going to mix it as it says. Once that's all done, you're going to separate it into three bowls. You're going to add food coloring to each one. I also added some juice from each corresponding fruit to its batter. You're also going to cut up some fruit to match each cupcake, and whatever temperature and time your cake mix requires, that is what you would put it in for. Then you're going to put your batter into its cupcake tins. I will say, as you can see me doing here, I did put them on top before I baked them. I will say that caused the fruit to sink, so I would say put the fruit on your cupcakes halfway into baking. Once they're done baking, take it out of the oven and remove all the cupcakes to cool. These cupcakes are surely fruity and delicious for any Animal Crossing lover to enjoy.
Those look straight out of the game and super delicious.
They would be great to make for a nice spring picnic since the weather has been so nice out lately.
Yeah, I'm so excited for this perfect weather. I can't wait to go out and enjoy it after this.
Lastly, we have a video by Ben Bartels about the internet's effects on teens.
Ever since the 90s, the internet has served as a distraction from kids. But in today's climate, how does the internet affect high schoolers' development?
I would count my phone usage as normal compared to my friends and family.
Boy, it's a mixed bag. In some ways, it's made scheduling and assessment of students so much easier to see the data, to figure out trends and which way students are moving, see where kids have strengths. It's really helpful in a lot of those ways. It's also very helpful in research. But then there's also the negative side of it, is that it has some issues of people becoming addicted to it. A huge percentage of our population is addicted to the phone. And adults too, like there's teachers that have the exact same problem. You know, they'll sit up and be watching TikToks. They'll think that it's, you know, it's probably like 11 and they look down, it's 1 o'clock in the morning. Oh my gosh, I got to get up for work in 4 hours.
I do believe that my phone is a much easier and simpler way to get the answer that I want, because when I have access to the entire internet and with just a few clicks of a button, I can get the answer rather than looking through what I have to. Socially, there's definitely a lot more stress when it comes to using my phone, because social media involves lots of drama and problems.
You gotta find a balance, and finding that balance is easy to say and hard to do, but we have to be honest with ourselves and really look at what are we accomplishing positively and negatively, and really try to balance those things out. I think if you set limitations on yourself, like I'm only going to look at social media things between this time and this time, and not pulled out in the middle of class and try to look at those things, if you can commit to that, you'll see positive trends in your education. Overall, if I was to have my way, I wouldn't have cell phones for kids in the school, because I think it interferes socially and with the learning process so much that it becomes a great hindrance. If students could use them responsibly, keep them up when they're supposed to be, and only use them for academic reasons, I think they would be amazing. I think they would do a lot of good. There's a lot of things that teachers can do with phones that would be helpful. So again, it's kind of a mixed bag. Like I really see some positives to it, but I also see a lot of negatives. And overall, I think that it's impacting kids negatively more than it's helping them.
I can see why it's such a controversial topic, because it's difficult to give the students that do need help the help they need from separating from their phones, and it's difficult to help the kids that don't even need help.
Phones are a very controversial item in high school as they can sometimes hamper other kids' learning. What do you do to limit your phone usage when you shouldn't have it out?
I'm definitely going to be more conscious about my screen time.
Same. Now, that's all the time we have for you this week.
Be sure to check out our socials on FHN Today and at FHN Game Day.
Once again, I'm Max.
And I'm Sassy.
Signing off.